thank you all for being here today. Greatly appreciate everyone taking the time. It's wonderful to be here with so many distinguished members of the community. Greatly appreciate Congressman Roy being here. Thank you for that. And it's wonderful. Wonderful to have Secretary Carson in the great state of Texas, and specifically in Austin, to discuss this, this very important issue. I'm Michael Burley, the regional administrator here in Region 6. I cover Texas and the four states that surround Texas. So again, it's wonderful to be here. I'll go ahead and turn it over to Mr. Robert Marbutt. He is the executive director of the U.S. Interagency Council on Homelessness. Thank you for being here, sir.
Thank you very much. And we really appreciate this, and most importantly, the Congressman and the Secretary, for your involvement in this critical, critical issue. And in the last decade, we've had a doubling of funding to address the homelessness in the federal system. We've had over a doubling in the amount of units in the permanent supportive housing units that we've had in the country, 231%. Since 2014, we have had a tripling of the amount of rapid rehousing units we've had. And all during this time, we've had a 20.5% increase in unsheltered homelessness. And when the NOFA changed, and that's a technical, that's how their funding gets granted out with HUD, and when that changed in 2013, the promise made was in 5 years, homelessness would end. And it just hasn't. We've gone the opposite direction. Not only have we spent more, we have tremendously more spending, we have tremendously more units, and the unsheltered homelessness has also gone up. And there was a real inflection point in 2013. And when you look in the report, you'll see the two data charts. And a lot of people say, well, you're cherry-picking data. I don't think there's any more important data than the national data that comes out of the annual reports of HUD. That's the aggregated national data. And we've just simply gone the wrong direction. It simply has not worked. And so it's time for change. And we need to make this change. And what we found when we started looking at it is one size fits all just does not work. The lack of being able to customize locally just does not work. The untying of services from housing. We used to have housing assistance and services tied together. We disconnected that. That's not work. And then there's generally just, we feel, too much direction from Washington. There's not a, we don't allow the local continuum cares, local communities, to best decide how to use that money. And of the all of them, the thing that we have found the most important is how important it is to tie housing assistance or housing service or housing vouchers with robust wraparound services that address the core issue of homelessness. And some of you have heard me give this story. It'd be the equivalent of checking into the Betty Ford Clinic and just getting a key in a room and not participating in any services and expecting recovery. That just doesn't happen. Or making services optional. That just doesn't what happened. The Betty Ford Clinic is successful because they have some packages of services that are required. They have some packages of services that are incentivized, and they have some packages of services that are optional. And a person takes those, and they have a great success rate. Bittinger Clinic, another place very, very similar. And so when you see how that goes, but we have disconnected from that. And there was a promise made in 2013 that we were going to end homelessness if we just tried this new way. We're now 7 years into it. It hasn't worked. So it's a time to change. What we want to do is bring back, and you can read the report with all the details in the report and go online. But we want to bring local decision-making back to local communities. We want to bring services back into the picture in a very robust way. We want to combine trauma-informed care that really focuses on the individual rather than just a housing voucher, but that you work on the whole person the way trauma-informed care does in a customized way and bring it back. And that's what the expanding the toolbox does, is sort of reconnects our view is we need to reconnect services back to the housing. And with that, I turn it back over, and thank you very much, Secretary.
Thank you for that kind introduction. And thank you to everybody. Is this working? No.
Check.
Testing.
It's more for us.
Okay. Well, thank you for everybody who's gathered here today. Always like coming to the great state of Texas because there are people here with common sense. It makes a difference. But it's great to be joined by some of our friends and partners like Representative Roy and Dr. Marvin, of course, and all of our other local partners who are gathered here today to share this goal of really elevating the forgotten Americans and getting them back on their feet. And today's discussion is especially important because our focus is on self-sufficiency and improving the federal government's policies and programs for our fellow Americans who are experiencing homelessness. Now, for a number of reasons, financial reasons, familial, health, and now economically induced reasons, by this once in a 100-year, probably more than that, pandemic, some Americans are only one, two, or three paychecks away from kind of financial disruption that could eventually lead to homelessness. And if there's no support system, homelessness will ensue. So that's where many of the entities, including the federal government, can play a very important role in helping our fellow Americans get back to a point where they have hope once again in their lives. But evidence shows that current federal programs and policies intended to address the problem need some help. And like Dr. Marbert just outlined, simply throwing money and money and money year after year after the issue just has not produced the results that were expected. And, you know, they say the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting a different result. And federal spending on homelessness continues to increase with minimum impact. And in fact, despite all of this funding, homelessness has actually been on the rise over the last 7 years. And we all know that, you know, it's not working. So at some point, I think we just have to be mature enough to accept that. We don't have to necessarily cast blame or aspersions on people. People have put forth very good, honest efforts over decades. And we can learn from the stuff that's been done, and we can build on the stuff that's been done. So it doesn't need to be an adversarial thing. You know, there are plenty of changes that can be made to improve the federal policies. And to even better news, there are more private and nonprofit partners who want a seat at the table to partner with the federal government to find ways to lead people back to self-sufficiency. Because the more people who are self-sufficient, the stronger we are in communities and states and as a nation. So over the past 3 years, HUD has examined and studied the department's homelessness policies, and we've worked with USICH to come up with a plan of action. And the changes that are being presented here today are hopefully going to significantly improve the homelessness programs, and we can reverse some of these trends that we're seeing across so many of our cities. Our department plans to effectuate the following initiatives in order to spur positive change. First, we will restructure funding allocations so that results are prioritized rather than application formalities and process. In other words, let's do things that make sense and that are showing results and not just follow the bureaucratic process. This will broaden the services available to individuals in need and allow Continuum of Cares to partner with other organizations in a better way. We'll also increase participation by faith-based organizations. You know, by funding groups that are achieving results but also have specific mission-aligned admission policies, which specify certain parameters for entry. And, you know, the nice thing about a lot of these faith-based organizations, they actually develop relationships with the people that they are helping. Those relationships are worth a lot more than just throwing money at people in terms of getting them to change the way that they're doing things. And, you know, these organizations should not only be resources out there, but, you know, in the past, we've actually excluded their services with some of our policies. And if we know our history, there was a time when they were the ones who did all this stuff. All the stuff that HUD is doing used to be done by the faith-based organization. So we certainly shouldn't be excluding them. That's the last thing we need to be doing. We will also increase local flexibility and accountability by updating requirements and reports so nonprofits are not micromanaged by HUD and its various funding requirements. And one of the things that is really going to allow us to do that is we've made some very significant upgrades to our IT systems over the last year or two so that we can actually know what's going on virtually in real time. And that really allows for a lot more flexibility. You know, too often it's easier to hit the ground running independently without the federal government because of our extensive applications and reporting parameters. And obviously, that's a change we're going to make. HUD also plans to continue its emphasis of self-sufficiency. Things like employment, training, job placement go a lot further lifting someone out of poverty and into a long-term self-sufficiency atmosphere. We also support more recovery and treatment programming so people can get the help they need. You know, as Dr. Marbert was saying, you know, just putting them under a roof in many cases doesn't do the job, particularly if they have addiction problems or mental illness problems. Those people can be helped given the appropriate attention. And I'm honored to work for our current president, who is committed to enacting bold, long-lasting changes. And this administration is committed to making this vision a reality for all Americans. So thank you. Thank you for being here. This is such an important topic. This is something that we can do. We have the resources. We have the intellect. The question is, do we have the will to do it?
Thank you, Secretary Carson. My name is Paul Webster. I'm a senior policy advisor for the Department of Housing and Urban Development. And I'm going to be moderating the rest of our time together. What we've done is we've invited folks in the community here in Austin and parts of Texas to just kind of have a conversation, really, about some of the findings that Dr. Marbert has talked about and the remarks from the secretary. I also want to definitely invite Representative Roy, as the congressman here in the greater Austin area. We want to make sure that we're understanding kind of your observations and what your constituents are seeing with respect to homelessness and housing in the Austin area. I just want to do a real quick introduction to our roundtable participants. To my left is Mike Ariella with the Texas Department of Transportation, very involved with some of the I-35 improvements and the interesting local impacts in terms of how homelessness encampments is impacting some of the downtown improvements here in Austin. To his left is Melissa Deuter, MD, from Sigma Mental Health Urgent Care in San Antonio. It's got a really interesting and unique service that provides mental health services to homeless individuals and families. And to her left, I don't think he really needs any introduction here in Austin, is Alan Graham with Mobile Loaves and Fishes and Community First, kind of a real innovator and fixture here in Austin with respect to the homeless. On the other side of the table, we've got Kevin Roberts, the president of Texas Public Policy Foundation. I know that you've been really focused on what's been going on here in Austin and as some of those impacts as they've been not only felt here in Austin but across the state. Next is Bill Bryce with ADX Helps. You're the local business improvement district right here in Austin, and I know there's been some challenges with some of the local policies and ordinances and how that impacts not only folks experiencing homelessness but local residents of Austin and the business community. And then next is Beth Biggs. She is with Family Promise of Baldwin County. Beth is a longtime COC participant. She's been focusing not only on what's going on with the faith-based communities in Baldwin County, Alabama, but also just the larger governance and community aspects of how the HUD programs are rolled out. And then lastly is Kenny Wilson with Haven for Hope down in San Antonio. You know, Haven for Hope is one of those programs that's just an exemplary program that does just so many things right. And so we really are just really interested in hearing from you all just in a general conversational way. We are kind of limited for time, so I want to encourage everybody to be really concise as much as you can. But I'm just going to kick it off and talk just real quickly about the issue of that's been brought up by Dr. Marbot and Secretary Carson, trauma-informed care and behavioral health. I know that there were, I saw some heads shaking. Melissa, I saw your head shaking. Kenny, I saw your head shaking. So if you've got some insights or some ideas, some reaction, we'd love to hear it.
Yeah, so I'm a physician licensed in Texas. I practice in the area of psychiatry and been practicing in San Antonio for about 15, 16 years, and only about 5 years working directly with the folks in the homeless population in our community. And that came about because our public systems that are in place to help individuals are complex, and they have developed over time very long wait times. So we had this existing model in our community where we were providing immediate care. And we came in and partnered with some of our agencies in San Antonio and began to provide that immediate care. And in psychiatry, we're talking about, you know, in individuals who are homeless, we're talking about schizophrenia, we're talking about serious bipolar disorder, post-traumatic stress disorder, autism spectrum disorders, addictions, heroin, you know, very serious problems, the most extreme versions of those illness states that lead people to be without housing. So coming in early and stabilizing and offering care can alter the entire course of an illness and can get people, you know, restored to the ability to even be homed. There are folks who are out in our communities who don't want to be in a home because of their mental health condition that prevents them from being able to do that. So I think this idea that we need to address root causes is really, really speaks to me in that way.
That's great. Thank you.
Majority of people who are on the street with mental health problems, if they in fact had appropriate counseling and medications, could function?
I don't know if there's research to tell us, but I know that a substantial number would, right? If the question is, would the majority be able to be restored to living in a dwelling, right? And the answer is complicated, but we have a number of people who are unstable because they lack access or simply because the absolute severity of their problem. And if we can offer them the services they need, we really do come a long way, because mental illness and addiction exist in far higher rates in populations of homeless individuals. They're just much, much higher than other folks, and we can't ignore that. We need to help.
Alan, I know that you and Kenny are just taking folks right off the street, isn't that right? I mean, what are you seeing in terms of once you're able to provide those services to them, and what is your experience there?
Unaccompanied male or female that lives on the streets and have been homeless for quite some time. Just to lay the groundwork of the men and women that live in our community, the average age is 58 years old. The average time on the streets is 10 years. 65% of our population battles two or more comorbid diseases, and the average age of death in our community is under 60. So we have a tremendous experience with this population. And I can promise you that when you live on the streets of anywhere USA, it will drive you crazy. And it in upon itself is a level of trauma that's beyond anything that you and I can really ever experience. And this is coming from someone that has spent about 300 nights on the streets with our friends. And this issue is totally mitigatable when we deploy the right resources in our village, which has a phenomenal rate of success of homing people, not housing people, but bringing people home. Is incredible. And when you really look at trauma-informed care and what it where it flows out of, and we believe very profoundly from a profoundly broken family environment, because we believe that the single greatest cause to homelessness is a profound, catastrophic loss of family. Because if you look at the numbers that are printed on here, this amounts to in the low 0.01% of the entire U.S. population. It's a relatively small number, and without question, they come from this cataclysmically broken family and forged family environment. And this is really what I like about what's going on here, is that we're trying to really re-empower the community to come up underneath the women, men and women that are out there on the streets. It's the forged family. It's from a biblical perspective, it's loving your neighbor. And that's
call it therapeutic communities, kind of therapeutic community model. Kenny, I know that this is kind of the heart and soul. I love on your website, you talk about your goal isn't necessarily housing, it's transformation. Tell me a little bit more about that.
Well, we're very different from Alan. Alan's my hero. We supported Alan before I got in this business, and we're a campus of, we have 27 buildings and 22 acres and on. And trauma-informed care is, we've been doing it for years. And when I hear cities saying, there's this new thing called trauma-informed care, we couldn't do our job without it. And we, every time, and this is, supports what Alan said, someone who's homeless, there's a reason. And we find it's trauma every time. It could be as a child, they might not even remember it. And so we focus on trauma-informed care. And Secretary Carson, you asked a question, and Dr. Duder is very careful, and I'm not as careful. I will say every time we get someone to Dr. Duder, which is every day, to her, it's an example of a partnership with a nonprofit and a for-profit, they get better. And then we find physical needs that were unmet and deferred, and we're able to treat the whole person. It happens often. And so this trauma-informed care, people ask me still, after 4.5 years, what has surprised you about being at Haven for Hope? And I say two things. One, it's more complicated than I ever could have imagined. Not just Haven for Hope, but the homeless issue itself is so complex. And then the second thing, and ties for the first, is the amount of mental health issues on those that are homeless. And Alan said it well. A person who's normal, whatever that is, if they lose their home, that's a trauma that they won't overcome for a long time. And we're there to help them do that, to overcome whatever trauma it is that they've experienced lately or long ago. We get to the root cause. And our job, we believe, is to, a word you mentioned, Paul, is transformation. It is a key word at Haven for Hope. In fact, Dr. Marvin knows this. My office is in the transformation building at the middle of the campus. And, you know, not long ago, a woman said to me, I came here 8 months ago and mental health was my issue. Now I understand it better than I've ever understood it. I'm medicated properly. Through the job program at Haven, I have a job. And through the housing program, I have a place to live. And I'm leaving after 8 months. I came here with no hope, and now I have more hope than I've ever had in my life. So that's what we do, and I hear that over and over and over again. And so it's not one thing. There's not one way to do it, is there, Alan? We don't look like you. You don't look like us. But we help people.
Noticed when I visited your place, there were a lot of people who had some mental issues, but you had recreated a sense of community, takes care of a whole mountain of problems when you do that.
You mentioned churches, and I want to say amen to what you said.
Just last night in the meeting, we talked about churches are saying to us, we want to help, but we don't know how. There's so much unused property and people there, and I think a relationship is a big part of it. And many have never had a sense of community.
That one of the challenges, it's great when you have those services and when you can get folks into circumstances, housing, to get those services, but one of the challenges that a lot of communities are facing is the challenge of the unsheltered. And right here in Austin, we've seen just increases. I was actually talking to a police officer this morning, and he said, I've been with the force for 12 years, and every year I've seen it increase. So I wanted to ask Bill and Mike, I want to talk to Bill real quick. You got to give us an overview. But Mike, I wanted you to talk just a little bit about the innovation that you created with the with your initiative in the homeless with respect to the I-35. So, Bill.
Thank you. Bill Bryce with Downtown Austin Alliance. Mr. Secretary, thank you for facilitating this conversation today. If I could touch on one point in your last question, and that is the efficacy of providing behavioral health care services to people who are unsheltered is virtually impossible. To try and keep somebody on a treatment path when they are living on the street with the trauma that occurs with that and all of the different implications, where am I going to find my next meal, a bathroom, a place to get out of the rain or cold, trying to keep someone on a behavioral health or physical health regimen or case management plan is extremely difficult. Here in Austin, to the question about unsheltered homelessness, since our 10-year low point based on the annual point in time counts, which was 2015, Austin has seen a 136% increase in unsheltered homelessness. And while permanent housing is a critical factor in addressing homelessness, we are not providing a roof for anyone that wants to get under one. We do not have the resources to do that. That increases that level of trauma for longer periods of time. Our chronic homeless percentage is 54%. That's 30% higher than the national average. And I firmly believe it's because we are not providing the front end resources to give people the opportunity to get under a roof, get the essential resources that they need, many of whom, as stated by the National Alliance to End Homelessness, can effectively resolve with those supports without the most expensive modalities of permanent supportive housing that are in tremendously short supply, and by the way, take a really long time to get built or to open up units in a rental market like Austin has, which has been over 95% for many, many years.
I appreciate, Bill, that's really some great local comments here, and I want to get back to the idea of flexibility.
If you go to Los Angeles and you look at the number of homeless people there and you look at the amount of money that has been allocated per homeless person, it's $400,000. Because, you know, you're using this permanent supportive housing model, you're losing all your transitional housing, all the things that really provide the mechanism to get people into the right place. So I think maybe they meant well, but this is where we have to actually look at the data and make adjustments.
Representative Roy, oh, Mike. Yeah, Mike, I want to hear, Mike and I had a great conversation, and I was referred to you, and I said, why am I talking with someone from the Department of Transportation about homelessness? This doesn't seem to fit. But we started talking, and you told me a little bit about the innovation that you're doing down here. I just appreciate if you could just tell that story to Secretary Carson.
So homelessness and transportation are pretty synonymous. We all know that hundreds of individuals experiencing homelessness use our highways as residents, and so it's not uncommon here in Austin. And so our operations overlap all the time. But in 2017, when all of the plans to reconstruct I-35, which is the major corridor, and you probably drove through here, was planned, and we realized all these bridges and overpasses would be going away, we realized internally we would be displacing hundreds of people. And so we wanted to be part of the solution, but we knew as a transportation agency, we really weren't equipped or trained to do that. So we're just smart enough to know that we needed our local partners to come alongside us. And so we developed the Mobility 35 initiative to address homelessness. And so I've, my private life, I'm also was very active in the faith-based area. I was a director in missions and outreach for my wife, and my wife had a really strong, you know, heart towards individuals experiencing homelessness. So I kind of knew all the players in town, and so we invited everybody, all including our local and state agencies, to be part of this initiative. And to our surprise, it took off. And so all we really offered was a big tent for everybody to come collectively. We were kind of neutral and agnostic on this subject as an agency, but we had good, solid partnerships and relationships, and that's what we brought to the table. Since then, our partners like Alan and Bill and all these folks have come together, and fortunately, we had these strong bonds because we were going out to the homeless individuals and saying, hey, this is coming, and then all of our mental health and medical service people were right alongside with us to help assess folks and push them towards housing. Then the governor asked us to establish a state-sanctioned camp. Luckily, we established this for over 2.5 years, and so we had all our local partners to help us successfully implement this camp, and it's currently operating. And so the only credit that we deserve is we were just smart enough to know that we needed our local partners to address this local issue.
Go ahead, Representative Roy.
Yeah, well, first of all, I just want to say that I'm grateful to have the Secretary here in Austin. I'm proud and honored to represent downtown Austin. I'm also represent a good chunk of San Antonio, so it's great to have you all here representing the great folks in San Antonio. Secretary and I met about this issue, I think in February or thereabouts, over at his office, and he's got a heart for this issue and has been a great leader on this about what we need to do nationwide. And so I just appreciate you all being here and focusing on this important issue. And the second thing that I think is so critically important, and it's great to see Alan. It's great to have you here. You're obviously one of the leaders in our community on this. It's great to see you, Kenny, as well on this. The importance of civil society, the importance of faith-based community, the importance of the nonprofit sector, charities, and driving this, and that the Secretary recognizes that that is where we accomplish the most for people, and that the federal government, the state government, our role in supplementing that and providing, you know, support to that is the right direction. And that recognizing that to me is so critically important because you guys are the ones on the ground, I think, making such a critical difference. And so I appreciate that. And the third point I wanted to make.
Can you give me a big amen on that?
Yeah. Hey, I'll give myself an amen on that one. I can't remember. I think we were over here talking about not wanting the federal government telling us what to do, and I was going to give a loud amen on that. That's how I'm predisposed. But the third point that I will make, and I'll be the guy that ventures a toe into the political waters here, not too much, but we're sitting here in Austin, Texas. We all know what's going on. In my opinion, it's not good. The Austin City Council needs to look at the city of Austin and decide if we want to solve this problem the right way, working together to do it and to work with organizations that can do it, instead of turning this into a politicized circus in downtown Austin where people are not safe, where the homeless community, frankly, are not safe. It's not good for the homeless community. And where, frankly, the danger is rising on the streets of Austin, Texas. And it is not good for the people of Austin, Texas. It is not good to walk around downtown Austin and be concerned about your safety. I lived on South Congress Avenue 20 years ago when I was in law school. Whatever mischief I may or may not have gotten into, which I'll not say anything about, I felt safe walking around downtown Austin, completely safe. And I'm just telling you right now that this is not a good environment, the direction we're headed as a city. And I think we need to take a look at that as a city. And I'm speaking directly to the city council. Quit playing politics with people's lives. And that's what's happening in this city, and I'm tired of seeing it. We're seeing the numbers. We see what's happening. You see a 45% increase in the number of people here who are now unsheltered and the homeless population, while you're seeing a 20% decline in transitional housing and so forth. That's not the direction we want to go. You see 10% increase in violence among the homeless population and growing. Just last night, somebody I know had a knife drawn on them on downtown Austin right across from the Stephen F. Austin Hotel. That's not how we want our city to operate, and we're better than that. So I hope the city council will work with us. And the last thing I'll point out about that is the worst thing you could do right now is cut the department of the Austin Police Department's budget by a third. That is not the right direction to go. We need to keep our streets safe. We need to be able to have partnerships with our police departments to be able to work with the Secretary and HUD and work with these great organizations that are on the front lines of civil society and our churches and come together as a community, as we're called to do. Those of us of faith, we are called to do, and we should do that together. And so I appreciate having this roundtable to be able to discuss that.
Thank you, Representative. I'm glad you talked a little bit about budgets. I wanted to talk a little bit
you know, Bill brought up the idea of resources and how local communities best use resources. And one of the things that I know the secretary and that Dr. Marbit has emphasized is that idea of providing local community flexibility and not being micromanaged. And I know, Beth, you've been involved intimately with the COCs that you've worked with. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, how you might respond to having additional flexibility in your part of the world and what you're doing?
Thank you, Dr. Carson and Dr. Marbit, for being here. Appreciate the invitation, Paul, to be a part of this, because I am not from Texas. I'm actually from Alabama. And thank you very much. I appreciate that. Yeah, but I'm a Jersey girl. I'm from New Jersey. But anyway, over the last 15 years, I've been involved with COCs and seen the value of them, and have also seen how the process and the policies, for those of you who are involved in that, have really, you know, strangled us in what we can do locally. And so all I can do is say, I plead that you would consider changing some of those things, because we could have very good caring communities and bringing people together in a coalition format to be able to address issues. And wonderful organizations emerge to meet those certain needs, very much like the ones that we're hearing about today. And then they are a part of this coalition, and then they hear about this $3.6 million coming to a community, or whatever, $9.6 million, whatever it is. And, you know, what are we doing with all of those dollars? And they go to very large organizations that are running permanent supportive housing programs with very little attrition of people not moving out. So, you know, I'd love to see, you know, some of the things that we could be doing from a federal standpoint and from a policy standpoint is that we include more faith-based initiatives in a part of that COC process. Let local people make those decisions about what's going to work in their community. And, you know, it may be unaccompanied youth. It might be inmates, you know, returning from prison. It may be families with children, no matter what it is. But we have to sit there and we wait for a NOFA to come out. And if there's any new money, which is very little, that usually comes out, Washington tells us what we need to use that money on. And it's like, okay, all right, well, maybe next year, maybe in 3 years, you know. So if there's some more flexibility, and then also more creative thinking about how we can move people out of permanent supportive housing to be able to serve more people, if that is a model that's going to be continuing, you know, throughout our country, we need to figure out how to do that better. And
you know, what you hopefully have noticed that HUD is that we've changed our definition of success from the number of people we get in the program to how many we can get out of the program and be self-sufficient. And you know, that's the philosophy that I think we need to spread around to everybody. It doesn't matter what their political stripe is, but when you think about the potential of a human being with a normal brain, what they can do, and some people think compassion is, There, you poor little thing, I'm going to take care of you. That's not compassion. Compassion is, how do I get this person to realize their potential and really begin to enjoy the fruits of that potential?
Can I just make one other statement? When you talked about that self-sustaining, being able to help people, one of my greatest excitements recently is looking at how I work with families with children. I'm in a Family Promise affiliate, which we are across the country. I know some of you are very familiar with it. We have about, I think, 15 of them in Texas. So it's a great model that keeps getting duplicated across the country, because we get to partner with churches. But one of the things that has gotten me very excited is the ability to work with families and challenge them to think outside the box. Yes, you might have that job making $12 or $14 an hour, but what else can you do in your family to raise income? Because just looking at all the, what they call the gig industry and side hustles, we all do it. to some extent or have at some point in our lives, how can we help people in low-income families to get another $400 or $600 a month coming into their house? That makes a huge difference of being able to make it through those tough times. And so if it's a dog walking business, a cookie baking business, a house cleaning business, whatever it is that we can help. So from that standpoint, just helping low-income families to make those extra dollars really, really helps. And I love to see HUD support programs like that.
Well, one of the things that I've been working for the last 3 years to try to get Congress to approve is, not raising the rent on people in subsidized housing as soon as they make an extra dollar. You know, that's not going to encourage anybody to do what you're just talking about. And, you bring another income-producing person into the household, your rent goes up. That's not good for family formation. You know, it's almost as if somebody sat down and calculated, how do we keep these people dependent? How do we keep them under our thumb? And we've got to find a way to break through that.
And, there used to be this term called empowerment, and there was a lot of focus at one point in time about empowerment and how we lift folks up and give them the supports that they need. And, Kevin, I wanted to kind of hear from you a little bit, particularly on two things. First of all, on this idea of what you're seeing in Texas in terms of kind of empowerment, self-sufficiency, but also I wanted to just piggyback a little bit on Congressman Roy's observations of what's happening in Austin in terms of increases in unsheltered homelessness, if you know that that's happening in other parts of Texas as well.
Sure, and thanks, Paul, for the question. I'll start by giving our friend from Alabama an amen. nice comments there. And thanks, Paul, for the question. Mr. Secretary, welcome back to Austin, and to my friend, Congressman Roy, thanks for your comments. I'll take those questions in reverse order. Our building for the Texas Public Policy Foundation is two blocks from here. Like Congressman Roy, I lived in Austin in the 90s, and it was a different place. And it was a place that was safe, including at 2 o'clock in the morning. You might ask, how do I know that? Well, I was in college. It was a place that businesses didn't have to worry about, and it's very different. And I don't, even though I'm a conservative, although I lead a nonpartisan think tank, I don't celebrate that 20 years of governance by the left has caused that. Although, leading a think tank, I have to call a spade and say that's what's happened. The result is, and this is the most important thing, is that when our employees leave our building after dark, but sometimes even in the middle of the day, this is no longer a safe place to be. I lament that for civil society. That is a problem that shouldn't concern just Democrats or Republicans or liberals or conservatives. It ought to embarrass us as Texans. And I can tell you that that problem is happening in almost every city in Texas. And so as Texans, regardless of where we are in the political spectrum, that's a significant problem. And then to move into the second or the first question you asked, but do it second, I would say that at the foundation, what we do is sort of what I've done today is listen to everyone's comments and take a step back and call a spade. We do what I like to call reading reality truthfully, even if that truth is ugly. And the truth on this is, and not getting into intentions, I'll follow the secretary's lead on that, that we have forgotten as we're building policy about two really important things. The dignity of every human person, regardless of what they look like, what language they speak, and who they're voting for. And the second thing we've forgotten is that we are hardwired by God, by nature, however you like to phrase it, to be a self-governing people. And our policy when it comes to homelessness has failed that. And I'm not just casting fingers to people on the left. We failed as conservatives until now, I will say. And so what I would say is what we're doing, or up to this point, what we've done in homelessness, is create the same problem we've created in education and in healthcare, where we continue to throw money at problems expecting that someone else will fix it with those billions of dollars, when we're forgetting the personal obligation we have, personified by Alan and our friends here, that every day civil society has to take up for that. And what we need to recognize from a public policy point of view is that government's in the way. And so let's just make a completely non-ideological conclusion. Let's just agree as liberals and conservatives across this country, starting in this city, that we're no longer going to politicize this issue. And let's think about the dignity of people. Like my homeless friend, Michael, I meet when I go into the Catholic Church one block from here. He's been homeless for 10 years. Can't get him to you yet, Alan. Or our friend at Texas Public Policy Foundation, Marty, who sort of is our security guard in some odd way. We can't get Marty stable enough to go into a program long term. But I mentioned them to put a human face on this problem. Those are the people we're failing. We're also failing our own kids and grandkids by not having the civil courage as a people to stand up and say, regardless of whether Republican or Democrat, members of the media, we're going to fix this problem. And you've got examples all around this table of how we can do it.
You get another amen.
So,
amen.
See, the biggest amens have been about local community and faith-based organizations. But one thing that has been brought up that I want to dive into a little bit deeper is what are some of the obstacles that are out there that are preventing communities and preventing faith-based organizations from doing more? I mean, you know, Baylor, I think that's another Texas organization somewhere around here.
Not really.
But so there was a study at some other university around here in 2017 that talked about how faith-based organizations provide the most beds in the majority of communities around the country. What do we need to do to spur more of that? Alan, what do we need to do, or do you even want it, the federal government to say, you know, we're here to help? Get that closer to you, Bob.
Yeah, I mean, there's a law that we've been studying, a federal law called the Religious Land Use and Institutionalized Persons Act, or LUPA, which was passed in around 2000, 2001, signed by a Democrat, Bill Clinton, that gave more religious freedom, land use freedom, to faith-based institutions. And we would like to see, and when you look at the amount of real estate that's owned by faith-based institutions, and look, here's just, I'm a keep it simple, stupid guy. There's about 12 to 1,500 churches, synagogues, mosques, and temples in Austin, Texas, and there's about 1,500 unsheltered men and women in the chronically homeless space. And if you can help me with that math, it actually turns out that what appears to be a giant issue can be very small. But if we put too much policy in place, that very small issue becomes a giant issue. So why isn't it that we wouldn't allow a lot of this unused real estate to be places where we can house? Do you know how many psychiatrists and psychologists and trauma-informed care people go to churches, synagogues, and mosques? They're everywhere. And so we have the resources within inside these little micro communities that if we unleash the power to do that, the policy power to do that, and help get the NIMBY forces, and I'll tell you, there's the NIMBY has its hooks in one issue, and that's discretionary land use planning, aka zoning, and that is what is preventing us. Almost singularly as a society, but if we could get five people over at this church, synagogue, mosque, or temple, and 10 over here, and 3 over here, where the community is coming up underneath with the resources that are inside that community, what would our nation look like?
That sounds like a conversation that Beth and I had over barbecue last night. And Kenny, I want your opinion on this too, because you came from corporate America into a faith-based kind of community. I mean, I'm sure you've seen some pretty interesting contrast there.
Well, I have, and all these amens and churches, I feel like I've been to church, and I can skip on Sunday maybe. But, you know, in a meeting last night this came up. We have historically utilized churches to get to know someone that leaves Haven for Hope. So here's a ready-made relationship. That doesn't mean it's going to happen, but it's a start. Last night we talked about just what you said, Alan, how much unused land is out there that churches have that is not used nearly all week long. And so I come from a finance background, and you said it earlier, Secretary Carson, common sense needs to prevail. the land costs in Austin for sure, and in San Antonio, it doesn't make sense to build affordable housing with the cost of the land. And we don't have enough places to put people at. I think the churches are an unused, untapped resource to provide people with places to live, and on top of that, provide a safe place and a relationship on top of it. We're working on that.
Riverside, California, that we visited, and they had land, so they built four single-family homes on that land, and they brought in four homeless families. And they used the resources that existed in that church, the professionals, the non-professionals, with a goal of making that family independent in the course of a year. And then they bring in another family. And the mayor works with them, the city council work with them, because, you know, this benefited everybody. It was a great thing to do.
Thank you for sharing. You know, and that model, Mr. Secretary, along with other models that are out there, allow government to play a subsidiary role to us, we the people, the constitutional we the people, to go out there and really be the tip of the spear, you know, at mitigating these big issues. But we've now abdicated the other way around, where we expect the government, and we go and yell at the mayor and the city council, wherever they are, to go.
The private sector on the front line with the government acting in a supportive role.
Yes. Yeah. So we've got some innovators at our table here today. One of them is Melissa with your model, and you and I talked a little bit about some of the barriers of getting folks the kind of treatment they need, you know, behavioral health treatment, mental health treatment. Can you talk a little bit more about what Sigma, how you came to be and the need that you saw and how you innovated in order, and if there were any barriers with that? And I'm just going to give you a hint. We talked a little bit about insurance and how that kind of played or didn't quite play in terms of the provision of mental health care that you provide.
So my business is a mental health clinic, and I have a team of people who serve our community, and we began in the affluent part of town, providing transparent pricing, low-priced community services so that people could walk in and get services. And we did that because the insurance industry, first of all, in psychiatry, there's still a parity problem. There's a reimbursement problem in psychiatry. But also, there's a prior approval for the specialty problem. So we were working after hours. We were seeing people on weekends and allowing them to just come in and immediately access a service, which the regulations and the policies and the insurance-based care would impede. So we started that way with a plan, maybe at some point, to delve into that insurance-based world that just simply doesn't work very well, okay? It would make it really hard. What we would have to do is we would have to raise our prices for the people who can pay to absorb the cost of the people who can't pay. But instead, we just don't charge anybody a whole lot, and we try to be fair. And that's the model we kind of brought in to serve the community of people who are homeless. So that we could come in, and the barriers in the public sector in psychiatry are different. There's a lot of money that's thrown into psychiatric clinics that are funded by the state and federal government. And whether they work well or work inefficiently, we continue to kind of use those same treatment models. And so we came in and we used our treatment model from the nice part of town that we then brought into that community. And really, we do exactly the same thing. We provide the same level of service. One of the things that I was speaking to Kenny about, and also Beth, before we began the session, was how grateful folks are in the homeless community, because I think they've never really had that doctor-patient relationship that we're providing, where we're giving them, you know, the same level of care as the affluent folks who drive up in their Escalade or whatever.
Yeah. So
Well, if I can just jump in there, this is so critically important, right? I mean, in terms of this whole issue we're talking about, obviously we're talking about homeless, right? We know all the numbers, right? We're talking about a lot of issues and substance abuse, mental health issues, and other chronic issues that people are dealing with. But the importance of obviously healthcare being central to all of this, right? And our healthcare system is broken, and we all know that. And
I'll amen that.
We're getting another amen, man. We're bringing the amens out. You're right. We're gonna be clear on Sunday for. But why do I bring that up? Because you just said the most important thing that's about this issue as well as healthcare, and it's all intertwined. Which is, I don't know why every conversation we have in D.C. and all these conversations about policy, it's all about the race to empower insurance bureaucrats and big companies to be able to manage our healthcare. Well, it's the last thing that we want to do. What we want to be able to do is have a patient and a doctor. We want to have a patient be able to go to a doctor, and whether that patient is somebody who's homeless and we're getting support for that individual, but it's or whether that patient is affluent, as you said in starting, all of us just want to be able to go to the doctor and stop going to some middleman or middle person to be able to go get the care that we want. And that's fundamentally central to transforming all of these issues, healthcare, homeless, all of it's intertwined. We're empowering bureaucrats instead of people. And we've got to get those folks out of the way and then get those relationships back one-to-one so that then we can help people who need it.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Bill, I think we had a little conversation about that just kind of writ large here in Austin. I mean, am I hearing that right? About how we've kind of got a middleman in it, and if we could kind of reduce some of the regulatory or increase some of the flexibilities, local communities would have better abilities to fill the gaps as they see them.
I think I'd be more adept at that by now. You know, I think that Austin has demonstrated that over the recent years in particular, when HUD has said we are focusing funding on veterans or youth to reduce homeless in those subpopulations, we've demonstrated our ability to do that. We've responded accordingly. In the meantime, we have this burgeoning increase in unsheltered homelessness of individuals, mostly men, mostly not veterans. And so I think that having the flexibility to focus on what we know is important, and that changes over time, as all of us know, right? So what we need today will be different than what we need, hopefully, 5 years from now. But right now in Austin, we have a crisis of unsheltered homelessness exploding. Part of that has to do with changes of the ordinances allowing for that, but it also has to do with where our focus has been. As I said earlier, it takes too long to create new units. In the meantime, people are out there getting sicker and sicker in many different ways, and therefore harder to house. And so I think having increased flexibility to allow us as a local community, and certainly I would think others, to focus on what they specifically need is really important. I hope that speaks to your question.
Absolutely, yeah. So we're coming towards the end of our time here, but I wanted to circle back to Dr. Marbot and the plan that he's put together, expanding the toolbox, and how do you think this plan is going to be received? I can kind of anticipate a couple things, but
you're identifying some things that everybody in this room seems to be very much in support of. But what is your anticipation? What's your hope in terms of looking at some of the response to this?
Well, first, I want to thank Dr. Carson, the congressman, and the panel. You all have identified what we've been hearing for the last year. Is what we're doing is not working. And this is a HUD event today, but our report also covers the education data and what's going on with the K through 12, and we're seeing very similar issues in that community too. There's a whole section. We don't want to forget the children and homeless. And the other thing we're seeing more of is children experiencing homeless are becoming intergenerational now. Much of the West Coast individuals that are experiencing homelessness, we find out, experience homelessness as youth. So what we know is not working. Peter Drucker always talked about what gets measured gets done. And if we continue to measure how fast we give you a house from your case manager to a key, rather than how successful the placement was, how quality, how many people exited homelessness forever, how many became self-sufficient, if we don't measure the right things, we're going to get the wrong thing done. And if we keep measuring the wrong things, we're going to get the wrong things done. So the time is to change. So to your point is, I would, you know, change is never easy. People don't like change. People that were invested in this effort over the last 7 years, that just statistically has not worked. I mean, our funding is up by double. Housing units of Housing First has doubled. That's in the last decade. Since 2014, rapid rehousing has tripled, over tripled. Yet street-level homelessness is up 20.5% around the country, with many places acute. I went to school here in the 80s, and then I came back for a PhD in the aughts. And I've seen it get worse. And then when I was going around this morning and last night, this is the worst I've ever seen Austin. It's moving toward Los Angeles-like. And so if we don't make change and make the adjustments that the secretary talked about, we're just going to get worse and worse and worse. The time has come to make change. You know, the definition of insanity is repeating the same mistakes and think it's going to get better. Or to think if you put more money into it, we're just going to... We got to fix some things before we start, you know, that we got some really basic things to fix. And I would expect that a lot of folks are going to challenge that, especially folks that were really invested in that old model that's not working. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you, everybody. This has been a great conversation. I definitely want to thank, obviously, Secretary Carson for coming to Austin and allowing us to focus on such an important issue. Congressman Roy, thank you very much. All of our panelists, your help is so invaluable to understand what we need to do to respond to your needs. So thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.